me and every moment of my life. Thank you to Philip for being for us today. If you wish to make an offering, please do so for all the patients. We're celebrating Holy Communion this morning, and everyone is welcome to participate. And thank you to all our helpers for the celebrations. After the service, we'll have the Yester Bolton and Saltoun annual congregational meeting. A few minutes after the service, we will take all and any of you asking after we say hi. The annual Humbie coffee morning takes place on Saturday, 18th March, 10:30 to 12 noon in the village hall in Humbie, and there will be lovely home baking, coffee and tea, salts, plants, paperback, raffle, and much fun for the community. The service is next Sunday, 10 a.m. at Yester on the street, and 10 o'clock at 11:30, the usual time, 11:30 in Romney, with Holy Communion being celebrated then. The next collection for the East Indian Food Bank will be uplifted on the 19th of March, and any donations you are able to make will be very much appreciated. You can bring them along to the service or get in touch, and we will arrange for uplift. Generally, if you'd like to attend any services or events and need help in getting there, please get in touch and we can arrange transport for you. Looking ahead to Easter, Annico would like to invite all of you who wish and can to make a flower or a flower garland or something similar for the Easter services. It can be made from any material, simply get creative and bring along to the services. It can also be purchased for small prices online. That's what it is, so you can do it yourself. And if there is interest, there will also be a communal crafting session. The club will be of interest to you. And finally, Ms. McDougall has asked me to remind you again of the planned meeting in the session rooms for 27th March at 7:30 to discuss fundraising ideas. So that's the 27th at 7:30 in the session rooms. And these are all the information as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John, and good morning.
Good morning.
How lovely to see you all here for our communion service today. Jesus said, "All who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The grace of God be with us all. Let us worship God. Our first hymn is number 120, "God We Praise You," and after that Alison will be leading us in our prayers.
Worship. Some sunflower oil that we put in.
promise.
Oh, When he woke from sleep, he thought, I'll go out and have a time. So the first night seized him, the garden found his eyes, they brought him down to the cross, and found him in the bronze shackles, and he ran for the blood. And our gospel reading is one to take from John chapter 4, verses 7 to 15. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask to drink of me, woman, Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no pocket, and the word is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give from in them is spring of water, rushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty, or have to keep coming here to draw water." May God bless us in reading the story of the Lord, and in his name be the glory of Christ.
Thank you very much, Paul. You sing again, number 540. I heard the voice of Jesus say,
"Oh,
that might, is that very involved? It can be quite fascinating, don't you think, to follow the storylines of the characters, to see what happens to them, what trouble they get themselves into, especially when it's all a bit more dramatic than our daily life. Perhaps that's not a bad thing either, to fill our appetite for drama by following fictional stories rather than experiencing them ourselves. One program that I have very much enjoyed, although it isn't quite so, is Dairy Girls. It's wonderfully irreverent and funny. As the name suggests, the story follows four girls in Derry, Northern Ireland. Oh, and another friend, whom they keep referring to as the wee English girl. It's set in the 1980s in a Roman Catholic community. And despite this potentially quite difficult background, it is a comedy programme, with Sister Michael at their school, the unchallenged star of the show. Despite all its glorious silliness, we are still introduced to the reality of the situation of the Troubles. The girls are very much Catholic. They don't know anyone Protestant. But there are attempts to bring communities together through a youth reconciliation program. There are very much two sides, two passions, very much them and us. I don't want to make light of the situation, of course. It is far too serious and has had far too many victims, even just very recently. Perhaps it's difficult to understand the conflict from the outside. And even if you are in the midst of such a situation, it can be hard to understand. As you know, I have spent the summer in Jerusalem as part of my ministry training. I had some time to meet the communities there, to get a bit of an idea of conflict that from the outside, once again, looks quite impenetrable. But I heard arguments from both sides and saw the suffering on both sides too. The one thing that did make sense to me, in amidst the pain, was the common longing for healing, the common longing for peace. At the end of the day, what the majority of ordinary people wanted, no matter if they identified as Israeli or Palestinian, as Muslim, Jewish or Christian, was peace, was to live a life in safety without fear for their lives and their loved ones. The conflicts there go back, of course, to the founding of the State of Israel, in the land that belonged to the Palestinians, but much further back than one century. There have been divisions and fighting for a much longer time, as we heard this morning. Our Old Testament story gives us an example of the divisions and the fighting between the Israelites and the Philistines. Now, I'm not sure how much truth there is to this claim, but I have heard speculations that the term Palestinians is derived from Philistines. You could just see that quickly. Philistines, Palestinians, Palestinians. The story we hear is that of Samson and Delilah. And while today we heard this episode, there is a whole backstory to it too. And not unlike this one, I can tell you. Samson lived during a time of repeated conflict between Israel and Philistia, when God was disciplining the Israelites by giving them into the hands of the Philistines. His parents had long been childless, but an angel of God appeared to Samson's mother, who is unnamed in the story. The angel tells her that soon she would have a son who would begin to deliver the Israelites from the Philistines. The angel also tells her that the child must never have alcoholic drinks or unclean foods, and that he was never to shave or cut his hair. He would be a Nazarite from birth, which meant he would be especially dedicated to God. After some display of divine power, she puts the staff in love in fire, the angel disappears. and make sure these are on this born and raised according to the instructions. When he has grown up, he leaves the hills of his people to see the cities of Philistia. He falls in love with the Philistine woman and decides to marry her despite the objections of his parents over the fact that she is not an Israelite. Saltoun is often seized by the Spirit of the Lord, who blesses him with immense strength. The first instance of this is seen when Saltoun is on his way to ask for the Philistine woman's hand in marriage, where he is attacked by the lion. He simply grabs the lion and drinks it apart. When he later returns the same way for the wedding, he sees that bees have nested in the carcass of the lion and made honey. Saltoun eats it. At the wedding feast, Saltoun tells a riddle to his third crewmen, who are all Philistines. If they can solve the riddle, he will give them 30 pieces of fine linen and garments. But if they cannot, they must give him the same in return. The riddle is a great account of the two encounters with the lion, at which only he was present. The riddle goes like this. Out of the eater came something to eat. Out of the strong came something sweet. Now the Philistines are infuriated by the riddle and tell Saltoun's new wife that they will burn her and her father's household if she does not discover the answer to the riddle, and tells it to them. And she cries before him for 7 days. Saltoun eventually gives her the solution. She passes it on to the Philistines. Must have been quite a pain. After they came back with the answer to Saltoun, he suggests that they could only have discovered it if his wife had been unfaithful to him. So he abandons her, and she is given to his best man instead. Saltoun then travels to Ashkelon, where he slays 30 Philistines for their arms, and then returns and gives those arms to his 30 troopsmen. I told you it was not drama, also. But we're not quite finished yet. Sometime later, Saltoun returns to visit his wife, unaware that she is now married to one of his former groomsmen. But her father refuses to allow Saltoun to see her and offers to give him her younger sister instead. In response, Saltoun goes out, grabs 300 foxes, and ties them together in pairs by their tails. He then attaches a burning torch to each pair of horses' tails and puts them loose in the grain fields and olive groves of the Philistines. The Philistines learn why Saltoun burned their crops and spurned Saltoun's wife and father-in-law to death in the retribution. Eventually, some time and various adventures later, Saltoun falls in love with Delilah, our story today. Now she is a Philistine too. She has promised 1,100 silver coins if she can discover the secret of Saltoun's strength so that they can finally capture their enemy. However, Saltoun refuses to reveal his secret and instead teases her. He tells her that he will lose his strength if he is found with very short strings. Later on, that if he is found with new ropes, she ties him up with gold while he sleeps, and he snaps both of them when challenged. She asks again, and he says that he can be bound if his locks are woven into a weaver's loom. She weaves them into a loom, but he simply destroys the entire loom and ties it off when he wakes up. But Delilah does not give up easily, and Saltoun finally capitulates and tells her, and God gives him power because of his consecration as a Nazarite, and that if his hair is cut off, he will lose his strength. So Elijah cuts his hair, Saltoun loses his strength, and is captured by the Philistines. They bind him, take him to Gaza, where he is imprisoned and put to work by turning a large millstone in fine grain. His hair begins to grow again, and so does Saltoun's strength. But that is a different story. nationality. In the Gospel passage, we hear how Jesus loves Samaria and how he comes to a well that asks the woman he meets there for water. Now, on the surface, there's nothing unusual to that. A traveller coming to a well in Market Square with a housewife with a shorter for their cooking and feeding. What is unusual, though, is that Jesus, the Judean, would ask a Samaritan woman for a drink. You see, Judeans and Samaritans didn't mix, something that we are very aware of course, from the story of the Good Samaritan. Now here, Jesus is the stranger. He is in Samaria, and he approaches the woman, and in the context, it is not surprising that she would question why he will ask her for water. And at first, the woman reacts as you might expect, pointing out that by custom, he should ask her for help. He shouldn't have approached her. Jesus knows what he is doing though. He knows that the woman is somewhat of an outcast in society due to her life choices. And he knows that he has something to offer her, that he can offer her healing and peace. That is what he describes to her, the living water that he can offer to bring life and life in all its fullness. Instead of focusing on what divides them, he reaches out a hand and offers healing and peace. Let's all be a little utopic. If we forget about the things that divide us, if we focus on our common humanity, wouldn't there be far fewer conflicts and less fighting in the world? Sure, we can't just put our heads in the sand and let injustices be our challenge, but more often than not, conflicts could be avoidable. Do we need to convince everyone that our way is the only possible right one? Hardly. There's usually more than one good way of doing things. And if we find ourselves in one camp with another one on the other side, do we really have to fight? Sure, in sports, say, there can be a healthy competition between two teams. But is it really necessary to carry on fighting off the pitch? There are plenty of people who are working for reconciliation, for peace, who are reaching out a hand rather than amplifying the fighting. In Northern Ireland, for instance, there is a Korean community who actively work for a greater understanding, for collaboration and reconciliation across the wider area. In the Holy Land, we find organizations like Sindana. Visiting this group and learning about them has profoundly impacted. They work in the Galilee, in an area of Israel where there are a lot of Palestinian Christians and Muslims living alongside the Israeli Jewish population. At Sindana, women from all of these communities come together to make olive oil soup, to read baskets, and to create other craft items for sale. And they share their stories. They get to know each other as people, not as someone from the other side. They relate to one another as mothers who fear for their children's lives, as human beings who don't want to be scared to go out of their door. Yes. They are all different, and that's wonderful. They all can bring different stories, different insights, different customs and traditions. They can share different recipes. They all are human. They all are in need of healing and peace. They are all in need of the water that gives life in all its fullness. Isn't it better than fighting each other? And then perpetrating the myth that just because we are different, we can't be friends. So in this time of Lent, let's look at what we can share with each other, rather than on what separates us from others. Let's leave the drama to the souls, to the souls which at the stage. In the real life, let's look and pray that everything we can give will be used wisely, with courage, for the work of God's kingdom. Amen. We now prepare ourselves to join together in Holy Communion. In this sacrament, we come together to celebrate our community, our communion with each other, and God's communion with us. We believe that in this sacrament, God is present with us, as Jesus promised his disciples so long ago. Because of this promise, and because we gather in faith, we can all celebrate the sacrament together, even while we are not all around one table, but with some joining us around other tables in different locations. In joining together in Holy Communion, we all are made one. You will find the responses to our prayers on pages 650 and 651 in the hymn book. So come now and gather with your friends and our church family. Come, share time together. Come, eat and drink together with the people of God here and everywhere. Live for love, dance in joy, pray for peace, practice patience, kindness and generosity. Live your faith, be guided by gentleness and self-control. As we gather to share God's gifts of bread and wine, we remember Jesus. We remember his life and his death, his stories and his teaching, the promises made and the gifts given to us the children of God. So let us pause and be still as we speak to God in prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
We shall give our thanks and praise.
It is right that we respond joyfully and happily at any time, in any place, to all that you God offer us. That we thank you and praise you for the life and love and praise and peace which you give us. And so we join our voices together with all voices on earth and in heaven, who have thanked and praised you throughout all of time, and add our thanks and praise to the angel song, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks for the good things in our life. We give thanks that Jesus forgives our mistakes. We give thanks that God gives us what we need. We give thanks for the Holy Spirit breathing life into us. We give thanks for the faith growing inside us. We give thanks for the food to nourish us and water to quench our thirst. Thank you, God, for the people to whom we extend our care, for the people we can support, for the people from whom we learn, for the people we can encourage, for the people we can strengthen, all in the name of Jesus. We pray for your blessing on all who need to know your love and your care, especially today, wherever we are in the world, whatever our pain may be. Be with us all and bless us, and pour your life-giving water out throughout the world. And now, as we follow your example, God, breathe your Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that they may be heaven's food and drink for us, renewing, sustaining, and making us whole, that we may be your body on earth, loving and caring in the world. Amen. God is here with us. The bread is made ready, the wine is served. We, as God's people, are gathered. The time is now to celebrate the feast of God. Come and share together. Come if you are hungry and thirsty, God will meet your need. Come if you are full, God will bless you. Come whatever your experience of God, and gain some more. Come, people of faith, and put your faith into action today. All are invited. All are welcome. Listen as we recall the story of why we come to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Jesus ate and drank with his followers in an upstairs room long ago. At the end of the meal, he took some bread from the table. He gave thanks to God for his generosity, and broke the bread and said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this and remember me." Then Jesus took his cup of wine. He gave thanks to God and declared, "This is my blood which I will shed for you. Drink this to remember me." So let us take the bread and wine, and as we eat the bread and drink this wine, remember all that Jesus has done for us, yesterday, today, and forever. The gifts of God are served for the people of God.
Thank you.
Then let us pray. For the bread is gone, but more can be made. For the wine is drunk, but more can be bought. God is always here. There is work to be done, good news to be shared, forgiveness to seek and to extend, love to be lived out. So let God in. Let faith grow. Let peace reign. Let hope be inspirational. In the name of the God who is the all in all, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We close our service by singing hymn number 113, God the Father of Creation. And after the service, you are very welcome to stay for the Yester Bolton Saltoun AGM. But first we sing hymn number 113. Maybe.